And in the impact segment tonight, a new poll by a Democratic organization says 51% of Republican primary voters believe President Obama was not born in the USA. I do not believe that poll. And here's the reason. The sample is so minuscule, very few people vote in Republican primaries. And to isolate them would be a challenge even for Gallup, much less a political polling center. So here's a better poll. According to CBS News, 58% of Americans believe the president was born in America. Just 20% say he was born in another country. The rest don't seem to care. There is no question that some Democrats are trying to marginalize Republican opposition in 212 by painting them as nuts, thus the birther polling. With us now, Fox News analyst Karl Rove. Okay, so there's no doubt in my mind after watching Gregory on Meet the Press on Sunday, grilling sure. Speaker Boehner about the birth certificate and all that. That the liberal, and Gregory is a liberal man, right? I'm not being unfair to him, am I?
No.
Okay.
So he may not acknowledge it, but he is.
Okay, but yeah. So it's divide. Let's divide the Republican Party.
This is the White House strategy. They love this.
How do you know it's the White House?
Well, look, the president could come out and say, here are the documents. But they're happy to have this controversy continue because every moment the conservatives talk about this, they marginalize themselves and diminish themselves in the minds of independent voters. And every moment we spend talking about this controversy is a moment we can't spend talking about the failed stimulus bill, the reckless spending, Obamacare, his failures in foreign policy, and his failure to live up to the promises that he made in the 2008 election. Look, he was born in Hawaii. If he was born in Kenya, then there must have been some massive conspiracy that said, oh, this guy being born in Kenya.
The factor already did the investigation. You know, and
birth notices both Honolulu newspapers.
You got that from me.
No, I got it elsewhere.
Oh,
with all due respect.
I reported it first.
Exactly.
Okay, now, there is, though, and you saw it at CPAC last week in Washington, D.C., there is an element of the Republican Party that's far right. Okay, and that really loves this kind of discourse. They love
the campaign for liberty types who were there for Ron Paul.
Right, they love Ron Paul. They loved Christine O'Donnell. They love that kind of stuff.
Let's be clear about it. There is a healthy dose, an unhealthy amount of people in that movement who are 9/11 deniers. I keep running into them. They protest me. Ron Paul, big Ron Paul stickers and so forth. They're birthers. You know, look, we had people stand up and boo Dick Cheney and Don Rumsfeld.
They called them a war criminal.
And because again, like you got a very thin
friend. How big is that crew?
It's not big at all. Remember, we had a lot of very sort of mainstream issues regarding, say, the Federal Reserve and hard money.
What percentage of
a fraction, tiny.
So this poll says 51% of.
Look.
I know this poll is flawed.
Now, but I do say this: Republicans had better be clear about this. We had a problem in the 1950s with the John Birch Society, and it took Bill Buckley standing up as a strong conservative and taking them on. And within our party, we got to be very careful about allowing these people who are the birthers and the 9/11 deniers to get too high a profile and say too much without setting the record straight.
But what percentage of Republican voters? 5, 10?
I don't know, but whatever it is, it ought to be less because we need the leaders of our party to say, look,
but you know,
stop
this
falling
stat
into the trap of the White House. Focus on the real issues.
Do you know this stat that was put out that 51% of Republicans?
Look, this is a lousy poll.
I know it is, but it's going to be picked up by, and
sure
already
is.
Has been, by the mainstream media.
Absolutely.
To demonize the rest of the Republican Party.
It fits into the White House theme line.
But isn't that smart of the White House?
Oh, absolutely. Look, these guys may be lousy at governing, Bill, but they're damn good at politics.
So it's a smart strategy to propagandize.
Because if we are where we are, which is, you know, we have a group of people out there who keep repeating this, and we have yet to get in a place where candidates are being asked about this in debates. Look, don't you think that in the Fox debate or one of these debates that's going to be televised, candidates are going to be asked about this? And if they step forward and say, look, we got better things to talk about than to fall into this trap that the White House has laid for us, this issue will start to go away. Even in this poll, 49% in this goofy poll don't agree with the proposition that he was born abroad. And even in the national poll, you'll see there are a bunch of people who are just waiting for people to tell them, oh, that's a non-issue, forget about it.
Why they're waiting. Now, the Tea Party, do you believe that the Tea Party is still gaining strength in America, or has it peaked?
I think you need to differentiate between the Tea Party movement and the Tea Party sentiment. Remember, the Tea Party movement itself is an expression of something that's bigger and broader, and I think is more important. And that is the sentiment that the country is bankrupt or on its way to bankruptcy, and we got to save it quickly. that sentiment is as strong as it was last fall. In fact, I think it's getting bigger, particularly because President Obama mishandled the budget in the way that he did. I'm writing my column tomorrow morning about this in the Wall Street Journal. The more I dig into the president's budget proposal, the more outraged I am at the failure of leadership. Look, we have had in the last couple of weeks two regimes try and give up power temporarily. Mubarak said, I'm going to give up power to my vice president. Obama says, I'm not going to be a participant in the budget debate. You know, don't take this seriously. Go look at the Republicans. And in each instance, the motivation was the same. Keep me in power. The president's budget is full of gimmicks. For example, catch this. Congressman Paul Ryan, there's a chart, S2. Take a look at it, and you look at the numbers, and what it says is this. Oh, we're going to save $1.3 billion out of defense because we're going to assume that we're going to fight Afghanistan and Iraq at surge levels for the next 10 years. And, oh, incidentally, we think we can begin drawing down the troops, and that'll save us $0.3 billion. Well, wait a minute, or $1.3 trillion. Wait a minute, that's already cooked in the cake. Why can you claim a savings of something that is already our policy? We're drawn down in Iraq. We are already saying in 2014 we're going to look to aim to draw down in Afghanistan, and yet they treat it as for the next 10 years we're going to be fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan at surge levels, and then we're going to magically get savings. He says, I'm going to save $1.1 trillion over the next 10 years. $1.3 trillion of it comes from savings that are already built into the budget, the military budget, at the planners at the Pentagon already.
So you say it's smoke and mirrors.
Smoke and mirrors. It's got $1.6 trillion worth of real tax increases, and you get all the funny money gimmicks out, and it's got $104 billion in budget savings over the next 10 years. And remember this.
That's nothing.
It's nothing. We're going to save that much in 7 months of the FY11 budget. Right. He's got $46 billion worth of spending built into his plan. The day before he came into office, we were projected to spend $42 trillion over the next decade.
Don't you get a headache with all of this? Just listening to it, my head's going boom.
He's a big spender, mate.
Well,
and you can get your you can get your hands around this bill. I know you can.
No, I don't know. Don't be too optimistic about that. Mr. Rowe, thank you. Plenty more ahead as a fact.